I want to thank the town of Calais for allowing us to do this through its select board, and I also specifically want to thank Judy Robert, who's in our cast as town clerk, and Donna Fitz, the town treasurer, and the Historic Preservation Commission, especially Scott Bassett, who really spearheaded this whole event, and Toby Talbot for reconstructing the entrance so that we would be up to the fire code, and Chris Miller for building this magnificent stage. Along with Nancy Tulis, and Nancy also painted the sides of the stage just the other day. So this idea came to me when I heard that this space might be available for performances. I love our town. I was in a production of the Linda Dillon many years ago and completely fell in love with the play. It's a play that celebrates small town life, so I thought it was very appropriate. And it's also a play that specifically gets rid of all of the trappings of theater. There's no set. This is basically what Thornton Wilder says in his stage directions. The only set are a couple of tables and some chairs, and all the props are pantomimed. They're supposed to be pantomimed. So we're doing our best. The actors, of course, this is a staged reading, so nobody's memorized lines. So the actors have to read the script, and so the pantomime's a little more limited than it would be in a normal production. So that's about it, and I hope you enjoy the show, and if you like it, tell everybody you know. We're going to do it again tomorrow, same time, same place.
This play is called Our Town, written by Thornton Wilder. The name of the town is Grover Corner, New Hampshire, just across the Massachusetts line, latitude 42 degrees, 40 minutes, longitude 70 degrees, 37 degrees. The first act shows a day in our town. The day is May 7, 1901. The time is just before dawn. Some streaks of light over in the east behind our mountain. Morning star always gets wonderful bright a minute before it has to go out. Done. Well, I'd better show you how our town lies. Now, up down here is Main Street. Way back there is a railway station, and tracks go that way. Polish towns across the tracks, and some Canuck families. Over there is a Congregational Church, and across the street is a Presbyterian, Methodist, Unitarian over there. Baptist is down in the hollow by the river. Catholic Church is over beyond the tracks. Here's a town hall and post office combined, and the jail's in the basement. You know, Brian once made a speech from these very steps here. Along here is a row of stores, kitchen boats and horse blocks in front of them. First automobiles going to come along in about 5 years, along to bank a cottage by the richest citizen. This is a big white house up down the hill. Now here's a grocery store, and here's Mr. Morgan's drugstore over here. Most everybody in town manages to look into those two stores once a day. Public schools over yonder, high school still farther over, quarter of nine mornings, noontime and 3 o'clock afternoon. The whole town can hear the yelling and screaming from those schoolyards. Now this is our doctor's house, Doc Gibbs. This is the back door. This is Mrs. Gibbs' garden, and there's corn, peas, beans, hollyhocks, and heliotrope, and a whole lot of butter. In those days, our newspaper come out twice a week, the Grover's Corner Center. And this is at the Webb's house. And this is Mrs. Webb's garden. Just like Mr. Gibbs's, only got a lot of sunflowers too. Right here, there's a big butternut tree. Nice town, you know what I mean? Nobody's ever remarkable ever come out of it, so far as we know. Early as tombstones in the cemetery, uptown mountains say 1670, 1680. There's Grover's, Cartwright's, Gibbs's, and Hersey's, same names as all around here now. Well, as I said, it's about dawn. Only lights are in town on the cottage over by the tracks where a Polish mother just had twins. And in the Joe Crowell house where Joe Jr.'s getting up so to deliver the paper. And in the depot where Shorty Hawkins is getting ready to flag a 5:45 for Boston. And naturally, out in the country, all around, they've been lights on for some time, what with melting and so on, but town people sleep late. So another day is begun. There's Josh Gibbs coming down Main Street now, coming back from that baby case. Here's his wife coming downstairs to get breakfast. Now, Josh Gibbs got 1930. The new hospital was named after Mrs. Gibbs died first a long time ago, but she went out to visit her daughter, Rebecca, who married an insurance man in Canton, Ohio. Died in the morning. But her body was brought back here. She's up at the cemetery there now, in with a whole mess of Gibbs's and Hersey's. She was going to do Hersey before she married Dr. Gibbs and the congregation of insurance over there. See, in our town, we like to know the facts about everybody. And then Mrs. Webb comes downstairs to get her breakfast, too. That's Dr. Gibbs. Got that ball at 1:30 this morning. And there comes Joe Crowell, Jr., delivers Mr. Webb's.
Morning, Dr. Gibbs.
Morning, Joe.
Has somebody been sick, Doc?
No, just some twins born over in Polish Town.
Do you want your paper now?
Yes, I'll take it. Anything serious going on in the world since Wednesday?
Yes, sir. My school teacher, Miss Foster, is getting married to a fellow over in Concord.
Well, I declare. How do you boys feel about that?
Well, of course it's none of my business. But I think if a person starts out to be a teacher, she ought to stay one.
How's your knee, Joe?
Fine, Doc. Never think about it. Only like you said, it always tells me when it's about to rain.
What's it telling you today? Going to rain?
No, sir.
Sure?
Yes, sir.
Knee ever make a mistake?
No, sir.
I want to tell you something. Boy, Joe Crowell there. Joe was awful right. He graduated from high school here and headed his class. So he got a scholarship to Massachusetts Tech. Graduated and headed his class there too. It was all wrote up in the Boston paper at the time. Going to be a great engineer, Joe was. But the war broke out and he died in France. All in education.
Nothing. Yeah, Chrissy, what's the matter with you today?
Ah, here comes Howie Newton, delivering the mail.
Morning, Doc.
Morning, Howie.
What is it?
Pair of twins over to Mrs. Gorosowski's.
Oh, twins, huh? This town keeps getting bigger every year.
Going to rain, Howie?
It'll be a fine day. This will burn through. Come on, Bessie.
Hello, Bessie. How old is she, Howie?
She's going on 17. Bessie's all confused about the group these days since Lockhart stopped taking her milk every day. Mm-hmm. She wants to stop legal court just the same. Scolds her about it the whole trip.
Morning, Howie.
Morning, Mrs. Gibbs. Doc's just coming down the street.
Oh, is he? Seems like you're late today.
Yeah, something wrong with the separator. I'm not quite sure what it was. Come on, Bessie.
Children, time to get up. George, Rebecca.
Everything all right, honey?
Yes, I declare, easy as kittens.
Bacon will be ready in a minute. Sit down, drink your coffee. You can catch a couple hours sleep this morning, can't you?
Mrs. Wentworth's coming at 11. Guess I know what it's about, too. Her stomach ain't what it ought to be.
All told, you won't get more than 3 hours sleep. Frank Gibbs, I don't know what's going to become of you. I do wish we'd get away someplace and take a real rest. I think it would do you some good. Emily! Time to get up! Wally! 7 o'clock! I declare, you've got to speak to George. Seems like something's come over him lately. He's no help to me at all. I can't even get him to cut me some wood.
Is he sassy to you?
No, he just whines. All he thinks about is that baseball. George, Rebecca, you're going to be late for school. George!
George, look sharp!
Yes, Bob?
Don't you hear your mother calling you? Well, I guess I'll go upstairs and get 40 winks.
Wally! Emily! You'll be late for school! Wally! You wash yourself good or I'll come up and do it myself.
What dress shall I wear?
Don't make a noise. Your father's been out all night and needs his rest. I washed and ironed the blue gingham for you special.
Mom, I hate that dress.
Oh, hush up with you.
Every day I go to school dressed like a sick turkey.
Rebecca, you always look very nice.
Mom, my daughter's doing so bad.
I'll come up and slap the both of you, I will.
Decided to put up 40 quarts if it kills me. The
The children say they hate them, but I notice they're able to get them down all winter. Can I hold up? I've got to tell you something. So if I don't tell somebody, I'm going to burst.
What do you get?
Here, give me some more things. Myrtle, did one of those second-hand furniture men from Boston come to see you last Friday?
No.
Well, he came to visit me. And first I thought he was a patient wanting to see Dr. Gibbs. And he wormed his way into my parlor. And Myrtle Webb, he offered me $350 for Grandmother Wentworth's highboy as I'm sitting here.
What, Julie?
He did. That old thing. Why, it was so big I didn't know where to put it. I almost gave it to Cousin Hester Wilcox.
Well, you're going
to
take it, aren't you?
I don't know.
You don't know. $350. What's come over you?
Well, if I could get the doctor to take the money and go away someplace on a real trip, like something like that. You know, Myrtle, it's been the dream of my life to see Paris, France. I know it sounds crazy, I suppose. But for years, I've been promising myself that if we ever got the chance.
And how does the doctor feel about it?
Well, I beat around the bush a little. So that if I got a legacy, that's how I put it, I'd make him take me somewhere.
Mm-hmm. And what do you say?
Well, you know, I haven't heard a serious word out of him since I've known him. No, he said, if I make him discontented with Rover's Corner to go traipsing about Europe, better let well enough alone, he says. Every 2 years, he takes his trip to the battlefields of the Civil War, and that's enough treatment for anyone, he says.
Well, Mr. Webb just admires the way Dr. Gibbs knows everything about the Civil War. Mr. Webb's a good mind to give up Napoleon and move on over to the Civil War. Only Dr. Gibbs, being one of the greatest experts in the country, just makes him despair.
In fact, Dr. Gibbs is never so happy as when he's at Antietam or Gettysburg. The times I've walked over those hills and stopping at every bush and pacing it all, felt like we were going to buy it.
Well, if that second-hand man's really serious about buying it, Julia, you sell it. Then you'll get to see Paris, all right? Just keep dropping hints from time to time. That's how I got to see the Atlantic Ocean.
I'm sorry I mentioned it. Only seems to be once in your life before you die. You ought to see a country where they don't talk in English and don't even want
to. Thank you, ladies. Thanks very much. Now, we're going to skip a few hours, but first we want a little more information about the town. Kind of a scientific account, you might say. So I've asked Professor Willard of our state university to sketch in a few details of our past history here. Is Professor Willard here? May I introduce Professor Willard of our state university? A few brief notes. Thank you, Professor. Unfortunately, our time is limited.
Yes. Well, Grover's Corners. Let me see. Grover's Corners lies on the old Pleistocene granite of the Appalachian Range. I may say it's some of the oldest land in the world. We're very proud of that. A shelf of Devonian basalt crosses it with vestiges of Mesozoic shale and some sandstone outcroppings, but that's a lot more recent, a mere 200, 300 million years old. Some highly interesting fossils have been found. I may say unique fossils. 2 miles out of town, in Silas Peckham's cow pasture. They can be seen at our museum at the university at any time, at any reasonable time. And shall I read some of Professor Gruber's notes on the meteorological situation? Mean precipitation, etc.
I'm afraid we won't have time for that, Professor. Oh. We might have a few words on the history of man.
Oh, yes, 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 yes. Anthropological data. Early Amerindian stock. Cocahatchee tribes. No evidence before the 10th century of this era. Now entirely disappeared. Possible traces in three valleys. Migration toward the end of the 17th century of English brachiocephalic blue-eyed stock. For the most part. And since then, some Slavs.
And Mediterranean. Population. Professor Willard?
Yes, yes. Oh, yeah. Well, the population at the moment is 2,642.
The post... Just a moment, Professor.
Yes. Oh, yes, yes, yes. I meant the population at the moment. 2,642, the postal district brings in 607 more, making a total of 3,249. Mortality and birth rates constant by Matresen's gauge, 6.03.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor. We're all very much obliged to you, I'm sure.
Not at all. Not at all.
Yes, that's right, Professor. Thank you again. Now, the political and social report, Editor Webb. Oh, Mr. Webb?
He'll be here in just a minute. He just cut his hand while he was eating an apple.
Oh, thank you, Mrs. Webb.
Charles, everyone's waiting.
Mr. Webb is the publisher and editor of the Grove Corners Sentinel. That's our local paper, you know.
I don't have to tell you that we're run here by a board of selectmen. All males vote at the age of 21. Women vote in direct. Well, the middle class, a sprinkling of professional men, 10% illiterate laborers. Now, politically, we're 86% Republicans, 6% Democrats, 4% socialists, and the rest indifferent. Religiously, we're 85% Protestants, 12% Catholics, rest indifferent.
Have you any comments, Mr. Webb?
Very ordinary town, you ask me. A little better behaved than most. Love black dollar. But our young people here seem to like it well enough. Now, 90% of them graduating from high school settled down right here, yeah, even when they've been away to college.
Now, is there anyone in the audience who would like to ask Editor Webb anything about the town?
Is there much drinking in Grover's Corners?
Don't mind that. I wouldn't know which one much. Saturday nights, the four hands meet down in Elbury Green on stable and they holler some. We've got one or two down drugs, but they're always having horses every time an evangelist comes to town. Oh, ma'am, I'd say liquor ain't a regular thing at home here. Except in the medicine chest. Right, good for safe, but it always was.
Is there no one in town aware of the...
Well, come forward, will you? We can all hear you. What will you say?
Is there no one in town aware of social injustice and industrial inequality?
Oh, yes, everybody is. Something terrible. Seems like they spend most of their time talking about who's rich and who's poor.
Then why don't they do anything about it?
I don't know. You know, I guess they're all hunting like everybody else. Where the diligent and sensible can ride us to the top of the latest St. Paul's and St. Bartholomew's. Maybe he's in the fun. Meanwhile, we do all we can to help those that can't help themselves. Those that can, where they go along. Any other questions?
Oh, Mr. Webb, is there any culture or love of beauty in Homer's Corners?
Well, ma'am, very much. I'm not in a sense hearing. Who would think of it as some girls play the piano at the high school commencement, but they don't like it much. They ain't happy about it. No, ma'am, there isn't much culture. But maybe this is the place to tell you that we have a lot of pleasures of a kind here. We like the sun coming up over the mountain there in the morning. We all notice a good deal about birds. See, we pay a lot of attention to them. We watch the change of the seasons. Yes, everybody knows about them. But those other things, you're right, ma'am, there ain't much. Robinson Crusoe and the Bible. Daniel's Largo, well, we all know that. Whistler's Love. That's just about as far as we go.
So I thought. Thank you, Mr. Webb.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Webb. Now, we'll go back to the town. It's early afternoon. All 2,642 had their dinner, and all the dishes have been washed. There's an early afternoon calm in our town. A buzzing, humming from the school buildings. Only a few buggies on Main Street. Horses dozing on the fishing boats. You all remember what it's like. Doc Gibbs is in his office and patting people and making them say, "Aw." Mr. Webb has cut his lawn over. One man in ten thinks it's a privilege. Push his own lawn. No, sir. It's later than I thought. There are the children coming home from school already.
I can't, Lois. I've got to go home and help my mother. Promised.
Emily, walk simply. Who do you think you are today?
Papa, you're terrible. One minute you tell me to stand up straight, and the next minute you call me names. I just don't listen to you.
Oh, golly, I never got a kiss from such a great lady before.
Excuse me, Mrs. Fortis.
Go out and play in the field, young man. You got no business playing baseball on Main Street.
Awfully sorry, Mrs. Fortis. Hello, Emily. You made a fine speech in class.
Well, I was really ready to make a speech about the Monroe Doctrine, but at the last minute, Miss Corcoran made me talk about the Louisiana Purchase instead. I worked an awful long time.
It's funny, Emily. From my window up there, I can just see your head nights when you're doing your homework over in your room.
Oh, what can you?
You certainly do stick to it, Emily. I don't see how you can sit still that long. I guess you like school.
Well, I always feel it's something you just have to go through.
Yeah.
I don't mind it, really. It passes the time.
Yeah. Emily, what do you think? We might work out a kind of telegraph from your window to mine. And once in a while, you could give me a hint or two about one of those algebra problems. Oh, I don't mean an answer, Emily. Of course not. Just some little hint.
I think hints are allowed. So, if you ever get stuck, George, you whistle to me and we'll give you some hints.
Emily, you're just naturally bright, I guess.
I figure it's just the way somebody's born.
Yeah, but you see, I want to be a farmer. My Uncle Luke says whenever I'm ready, I can come over and work on his farm. If I'm any good, I can just gradually have it.
You mean the house and everything?
Yeah.
Well, thanks. I better be getting out to the baseball field. Thanks for the talk, Emily. Good afternoon, Mrs. Webb.
Good afternoon, George.
So long, Emily.
So long, George. Emily, come help me string these beans for the winter, George Gibbs. Oh, he let himself have a real conversation, didn't he? He's grown up. How old would George be?
10 years old.
Let me see. Must be almost 16.
Mom, I made a speech in class today and I was very good at it.
You must recite it to your father in summer. What was it about?
The Louisiana Purchase.
It was like silk off a spool.
I'm going to make speeches all my life.
Mama, aren't these big enough? Try and get them a little bigger if you can.
Mama, will you answer me a question serious?
Seriously, dear, not serious.
Seriously. Mama, am I good looking?
Of course you are. All my children have got good features. I'd be ashamed if they haven't.
Mama, that's not what I mean. What I mean is, am I pretty?
I've already told you, yes. Now that's enough of that. You have a nice, young, pretty face. Never heard of such foolishness.
Mama, you never tell us the truth about anything.
I am telling you the truth.
Mama, were you pretty?
What we can piece together out of the open bones and comedies they wrote for the theater.
deserve to fly. See what I mean? So people a thousand years from now, this is the way we were. In the provinces of New York, north of New York, at the beginning of the 20th century. This is the way we were. In our growing up, our marriage, and in our living, and in our dying.
Cooking meals all day long, washing and ironing.
And still, she has to go out in the backyard and chop wood. I suppose she just got tired of asking you. She just gave up and decided it was easier to do it herself. And you eat her meals and put on the clothes she keeps nice for you. And you run off and play baseball like she's some hired girl we keep around the house but that we don't like very much. Well, I knew all I had to do was call your attention to it. Here's a handkerchief, son. George, I've decided to raise your spending money 25 cents a week. Not, of course, to chopping wood for your mother, because that's a present you give her, but, well, because you're getting older, and I imagine there are lots of things you must find to do with it.
Thanks, Father.
Let's see here. Tomorrow's your payday. You can count on it. Rebecca probably will feel she ought to have some more, too. I wonder what could have happened to your mother. Choir practice was never as late as this before.
It's only 8:30, huh?
Yeah, I don't know why she's in that old choir. She hasn't any more voice than an old crow. Traipsing around the streets at this hour of the night. Well, it's just about time you retired, don't you think?
Yes, Pa.
Small town life. I don't know how that'll end, but there's nothing we can do.
just to leave it alone. Now come, get in.
No, Franca. Franca, I'm worried about you.
What are you worried about?
I think it's my duty to make plans for you to get a real rest and change. And if I get that legacy, well, I'm going to insist on it.
Now, Julia, there's no sense in going over that again.
Frank, you're unreasonable. Oh,
come on, Julia, it's getting late. First thing you know, you'll catch cold. I gave George a piece of my mind tonight. I reckon you'll have your wind chopped for a while, anyway.
No, go on. It's time getting upstairs.
Yeah, there's always so much to pick up, it seems. You know, Frank, Mrs. Fairchild always locks her front door every night. All those people up that part of town do.
They're all getting citified. That's the trouble with them. They haven't got nothing fit to burgle, and everybody knows it.
Thank you.
climbed up a flight of stairs like they used to. Lost their heart fluttering a little. All that can happen in 1,000 days. Nature has pushed contrived in another way too. A number of young people have fell in love and got married. Yes, mountains got bit away a few fractions of an inch. Millions of gallons went by, water went by the mill, and here and there a new home was set up on the roof. Almost everybody in the world gets married. You know what I mean? In our town, there aren't hardly any exceptions. Most everybody in the world climbs into their grave now. The first act was called the daily life. This act is called love and marriage. There's another act coming after this. I reckon you can guess what that's about. So, it's 3 years later, 1904. It's July 7th, just after high school commencement. That's the time most of our young people jump up and get married. As soon as they pass their last examination in solid geometry and Cicero's oration, looks like they suddenly feel themselves fit to be married. It's early morning. Only this time it's been raining. It's been pouring and thundering. Mrs. Gibbs' garden and Mrs. Webb's here, drenched. All those bean poles and pea vines, dreadful. All yesterday, down there on Main Street, the rain looked like curtains being blown along. May begin again any minute. There, you can hear the 5:45 for walk. Hello, Mrs. Gibbs. This is Webb coming out for breakfast. Though it were an ordinary day, I don't have to point out that the women in my audience, those ladies they see before them, both of them ladies cook 3 meals a day, one for 20 years, the other for 40, and no summer vacation. They brought up 2 children to feed, washed, cleaned the house, never a nervous breakdown. It's like what one of those Middle West poets said. You've got to love life to have life. You've got to have life to love life. It's what they call a vicious circle.
Yeah, Bessie.
Here comes High Newton delivering the mail, and another sky crowd delivering the papers, like his brother before.
Morning, Hallie.
Morning, Si. Anything in the papers this afternoon?
Nothing much. About the best baseball pitcher Grover's firm has ever had, George Gibbs.
I reckon he is.
He could hit and run bases, too.
Yep, mighty fine ball player. Whoa, Bessie. Just like to stop and have a cop if I'm trying to.
I don't see how we could give up a thing like that just to get married. Could you, Howie?
Well, I can't tell, so I never had no talent that way. Morning.
Morning.
Say early, Bill.
Yeah, Stephen said it's got to do it to prevent a flood. The river's been rising all night.
Zach Crowell here, all worked up about George Gibbs retiring from baseball.
Yes, sir, that's the way it goes. Back in 84, we had a player, Cy. Even George Gibbs couldn't touch him. Name of Hank Todd. Went down in Maine to become a parson. A wonderful ball player, Howie. How does the weather look to you?
Oh, not too bad. I think they could clear up for good.
Morning.
Yes.
Morning, Howie. I think it's going to rain again.
I don't know. I think it's raining so heavy it will clear up.
Certainly hope it will.
How much do you want today?
I'm going to have a house full of relations today, Howie. Looks like I'll need 3 a cream and 2 a milk.
Now, my wife says to tell you. We hope they'll both be very happy. I know they will.
Thanks a lot, Howie. Tell your wife I hope she can get there to the wedding.
Oh, yeah, she'll be there. She'll be there if she can.
it start raining again, Mr. Newsom?
Well, I was just saying to Mrs. Gibbs that it may lighten up. And Mrs. Newsom told me to tell you that we both hope they'll be very happy. No, they will.
Thank you. And thanks to Mrs. Newsom, and we're counting on seeing you at the wedding.
Oh, we hope you get there. Who missed that? Come on, Missy.
Well, Mom, the day has come. You're losing one of your treats.
Greg Gibbs, don't say another word. I feel like crying every minute. Sit down and drink your coffee.
Groom's up shaving himself. Only there ain't an awful lot to shave. Whistling and singing like he's glad to leave us. Every now and then he says, I do. The mirror. That don't sound convincing to me.
I declare, Frank, I don't know how he'll get along. I've arranged his clothes and seen to it that he's put warm things on. Frank, they're too young. Emily won't think of such things. He'll catch a death of cold within a week.
I was remembering my wedding morning.
No, stop with that, Frank.
I was the scariest young fella in the state of New Hampshire. I thought I'd made a mistake for sure. And when I saw you coming down that aisle, I thought you were the prettiest girl I'd ever seen. But the only trouble was I'd never seen you before. There I was in the Congregational Church, marrying a total stranger.
And how do you think I felt? Frank, weddings are just awful. They're farces. Here, I've made something for you.
Why, Julia Hersey, French toast!
Came hard to make, and I had to do something.
Well, how'd you sleep last night, Julia?
Well, I heard a lot of the hours struck off.
Yes. I get a shock every time I think of George setting out to be a family man. That great gangling thing. I tell you, Julia, there's nothing so terrifying in the world as a son. The relation of father and son is the darndest, awkwardest.
Mother and daughter's no picnic either, let me tell you.
Yeah, they'll have a lot of troubles, I suppose, but that's none of our business. Everybody has a right to their own troubles.
Yes, people are meant to go through life two by two. It ain't natural to be lonesome.
Julia, do you know one of the things I was scared of when I married you?
Go along with you.
I was afraid we wouldn't have material for conversation nor to last us a few weeks. I was afraid we'd run out and eat our meals in silence, that's a fact. Well, you and I have been conversing for 20 years now without any noticeable bear of stops.
Well, good weather, bad weather. Tain't very choice, but I always find something to say. Did you hear Rebecca stirring around upstairs?
No. On day of the year, Rebecca hasn't been managing everybody's business up there. She's hiding in the room. I got the impression she's crying.
Oh, Lord sakes. This has got to stop. Rebecca! Rebecca! Come down and get your breakfast.
Good morning, everybody. Only 5 more hours to live.
George, where are you going?
Just stepping across the grass to see my girl.
Now, George, you put on your overshoes. It's raining torrents, and you don't go out of this house without you prepared for it.
Oh, Mama, it's just a step.
George, you'll catch a death of cold, and you'll cough all through the service.
George, do as your mother tells you.
From tomorrow on, you can kill yourself in all kinds of weather, but while you live under my roof, you'll live wisely, thank you. And maybe Mrs. Webb isn't used to having callers at 7 in the morning. Here, take a cup of coffee first.
Be back in a minute. Mr. Wade, you don't believe in that superstition, do you?
There's a lot of common sense in some superstitions, George.
Millions have followed it, George, and you don't want to be the first to fly in the face of custom.
How is Emily?
She hasn't waked up yet. I haven't heard a sound out of her.
Emily's asleep?
Yeah. No wonder. We were up till all hours sewing and packing. Yeah. I'll tell you what I'll do. You sit down here a minute with Mr. Webb. You drink this cup of coffee. Come on. I'll go upstairs and see if she doesn't come out and surprise you. Now, here's some bacon too, but don't be long about it.
Mr. Webb, what sense could there be in a superstition like that?
Well, you see, on a wedding morning, girls' heads have to be full of clothes and one thing or another. Don't you think that's probably it?
Yes, I never thought of that.
The girl's head, girls have to be quite nervous on a wedding day.
I wish a fellow could get married without all that marching up and down.
Every man that's ever lived has felt that way about it, George. Hasn't been any use. It's the women folk who've built up weddings, my boy. For a while now, the women have it all their own. Man looks pretty small at a wedding, George. All those good women standing shoulder to shoulder, making sure that knot's tied in a mighty public way.
But you believe it, don't you, Mr. Horton?
Oh, yes. Don't misunderstand me, my boy. A marriage is a wonderful thing. No, a wonderful thing. Don't you forget that, George.
No, sir. Mr. Webb, how old were you when you got married?
Well, you see, I'd been to college, and I'd take a little time to get settled. And Mrs. Webb, she wasn't much older than what Emily is. Oh, age hasn't much to do with it, George. Not compared with other things.
What were you going to say, Mr. Webb?
Oh, I don't know. Was I going to say something? George, I was thinking the other night of some advice my father gave me when I got married. Charles, he said, Charles, start out early showing who's boss, he said. Best thing to do is give an order, even if it don't make any sense. Just so she'll learn who to obey. And he said, if anything about your wife irritates you, or conversation, or anything, just get up and leave the house. That'll make it clear. Yes, that'll make it clear. Oh, yes, he said, never let your wife know how much money you have. Never.
Well, Mr. Webb, I don't think
so. I took the opposite of my father's advice, and I've been happy ever since. Let that be a lesson to you, George. Never ask anybody's personal advice on personal matters. George, you're going to have chickens on your phone?
What?
Oh, are you going to raise chickens on your phone?
Well, Uncle Luke's never been much interested, but I
know. A book came into my office the other day, George, on the phylo system of raising chickens. I hope you read it. See, I'm thinking of beginning in a small way in the backyard. I'm going to put an incubator in the cellar.
Charles, are you talking about that old incubator again? I thought you two would be talking about things worthwhile.
Well, Worm, if you want to give the boy some good advice, I'll go upstairs and be alone.
George, Emily's got to come downstairs and eat her breakfast. She sent you her love, but she doesn't want to lay eyes on you. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
I guess you don't know about another superstition, an old one.
What do you mean, Charles?
Since the cavemen, no bridegroom should see his father-in-law on the day of the wedding. <morning. laughs>
Thank you, Mrs. Webb. Now I have to interrupt here again. You see, we want to know how all this began, this wedding, this plan to spend a lifetime together. I'm awfully interested in how it
to and you make some decisions. Then you're 70, you've been a lawyer for 50 years, and that white-haired lady at your side has eaten over 50,000 meals with you. How does such things begin? George and Emily are going to show you now the conversation they had when they first knew that, as the saying goes, that they were meant for one another. But before they do, I want you to try and remember what it was like to have been very young, and particularly the days when you were first in love, when you were like a person sleepwalking, and you didn't quite see the street you were in, and didn't quite hear everything else said. You're just a little bit crazy. Will you remember that, please? Now, they'll be coming out of high school at 3 o'clock. George has just been elected president of the junior class, and as it's June, that means he'll be president of the senior class all next year. And Emily's just been elected secretary and treasurer. Now, I don't have to tell you how important that is. Yeah. There they are. Come down Main Street now.
I can't, it's a wheeze. I've got to go home. Goodbye.
No, Ernest, can you come over tonight and do Latin?
I think Cicero the worst.
Tell your mother you have to. Goodbye, Helen. Goodbye, Fred.
Can I carry your books home for you, Emily? Excuse me a minute, Emily. See, Bob, we're finally a little late. Start practice anyway. And give her some long eyelids.
Goodbye, Lizzie.
Goodbye, Lizzie.
I'm awfully glad you were elected, too, Emily.
Thank you.
Emily, why are you mad at me?
I'm not mad at you.
You're treating me so funny lately.
Well, since you asked me, I might as well say it right out. George. Goodbye, Miss Corcoran.
Goodbye, Miss Corcoran.
What is it?
I don't like the whole change that's come over me in the last year. I'm sorry if that hurts your feelings, but I've got to tell the truth and shame the devil.
A change? What do you mean?
Well, up to a year ago, I used to like you a lot. And I used to watch you and see you did everything. Because we've been friends for so long. Then you began spending all your time in baseball. And you never stopped to speak to anybody anymore. Not even to your own family didn't. And George, it's a fact. You've gotten awful conceited and stuck up, and all the girls say so. Well, they don't say so to your face. That's what they say about you behind your back, and it hurts me to hear them say it, but I've got to agree with them a little. I'm sorry if I hurt your feelings, but I can't be sorry I said it.
I'm glad you said it, Emily. I never thought that such a thing was happening to me. I guess it's hard for a fella not to have faults creep into his character.
I always expect a man to be perfect, and I think he should be.
Oh, I don't think it's possible to be perfect, Emily.
Well, my father is. As far as I can see, your father is. There's no reason on earth why you shouldn't be too.
Well, I feel it's the other way around, that men aren't naturally good, but girls are.
Well, you might as well know by now that I'm not perfect. It's not easy for a girl to be as perfect as a man, because we girls are more nervous. No, I'm sorry I said all that about you. I don't know what made me say it.
Emily.
Now I can see it, not the truth at all. And I suddenly feel that it isn't important anyway.
Emily, would you like an ice cream soda or something before you go home?
How are you? Good afternoon, Mrs. Slocum.
One thing wrong.
when you said for you that I wasn't noticing people. And you, for instance. Why you say you were watching me when I did everything. I was doing the same about you all the time. Why, sure, I always thought about you as one of the chief people I thought about. I always made sure where you were sitting on the bleachers and who you were with. For 3 days now, I've been trying to walk home with you, but something always got in the way. Yesterday, I was standing over against the wall waiting for you, and you walked home with Miss Corcoran.
George! Life's awful funny. How could I have known you? I thought...
Listen, Emily. I'm going to tell you why I'm not going to agriculture school. I think that once you've found a person that you're very fond of, I mean a person who's fond of you too, and likes you enough to be interested in your character. Well, I think that's just as important as college is, and even more so. But that's what I think.
I think it's awfully important, too.
Emily?
Yes, George?
Emily, if I do improve and make a big change, would you be... I mean, could you be?
I am now. I always have been.
So I guess this is an important talk we should have.
Yes. Yes.
Millions of them.
Most of them set out to live two by two also. Millions of them. Well, as all my sermons weren't very long, anyway.
What? Where's Emily?
Oh, George, you gave me such a turn.
Cheer up, Ma. I'm getting married.
Let me catch my breath.
Now, Ma, you save Thursday nights. Emily and I are coming over to dinner every Thursday night. You'll see. Ma, what are you crying for? Come on, we've got to be ready for this.
I'm going to
love me, help me. All I want is someone to love me.
I will. I'll try.
And I mean forever. Do you hear? Forever and ever.
Come on, they're waiting for us. No.
Do you, George, take this woman, Emily, to be your wedded wife? You have
perfectly lovely wedding. Loveliest wedding I ever saw. Oh, I do love a good wedding, don't you? Doesn't she make a lovely bride?
I do.
Do you, Emily, take this man, George, to be your wedded husband?
Don't know when I've seen such a lovely wedding. But I always cry. Don't know why it is, but I always cry. I just like to see young people happy, don't you? Oh, I think it's lovely.
I've married over 200 couples in my day. Do I believe in it? I don't know. If marriage ends, millions of them. The cottage, the go-kart, the Sunday afternoon drives in the Ford, the first rheumatism, the grandchildren, the second rheumatism, the deathbed, the reading of the will, once in a thousand times, it's interesting. City people for looking up their ancestors. They want to make sure they're see more than 50 miles of themselves. All they knew was the name, friend. The United States of America. The United States of America. And they went and died about it. Now this here is the new part of the cemetery, and here's your friend, Mrs. Gibbs, and let me see, Mr. Stimson, organist at the Congregational Church, and Mrs. Soames, who enjoyed the wedding so, you remember? Oh, no. A lot of others. Editor Webb for the Wallace. He was appendix burst while he was on a Boy Scout trip to Crawford Notch. Yeah, an awful lot of sorrow was sort of quieted down here. People just wild with grief and brought their relatives up to this hill. We all know how it is. And then time, sunny days and rainy days and snow. We're all glad that in a beautiful place. We're coming up here ourselves when our fit's over. Now there are some things we all know, but we don't take them out and look at them very often. We all know that something is eternal. And it ain't houses, and it ain't names, and it ain't earth, and it ain't even the stars. Everybody knows in their bones that something is eternal. And that something has to do with human beings. All the greatest people ever lived have been telling us that for 5,000 years. And yet you'd be surprised how people always lose hope. There's something way deep down that's eternal. About every human being. Now you know, as well as I do, that the dead don't stay interested in us living people for very long. Gradually, they lose hold of the earth, and the ambitions they had, and the pleasure they had, and the things they suffered, and the people they loved. They get weaned away from earth. That's the way I put it. Weaned away. And they stay here while the earth part of them burns away. Burns out. And all that time they slowly get indifferent to what's going on in Grover's Corners. They're waiting. They're waiting for something that they feel is coming. Something important and great. Aren't they waiting for the eternal partner to come out here? Some of the things I want to say maybe will hurt your feelings, but that's the way it is. Mother and daughter, husband and wife, enemy and enemy, money and miser. All those terribly important things kind of grow pale around here. What's left when memory's gone and your identity, Mr. Smith? Well, there are some good people here. The old starter, the undertaker, supervises a new made grave. Here's a Grover's Corner boy that left town to go out west.
Well, good afternoon, Joe Stoddard.
Good afternoon.
How can you see now? Do I know you?
I'm Sam Craig.
Oh, goodness sakes alive. All the people. I should have known you'd be back for the funeral. You've been away a long time, Sam.
Yes, I've been away over 12 years. I'm in business out of Buffalo now. Yeah, but I was in the East when I got news of my cousin's death. So I thought I'd combine things a little and come and see the old home. Will you look well?
Yes, yes, can't complain. Very sad, our journey today, Samuel.
Yes, yes.
Yes, yes, I always said I hate to supervise when a young person is taken. They'll be here in a few minutes now. I had to come here early today. My son's supervising at the house.
Old Farmer McCarty. I used to do chores for him. Yeah, after school. He had the lumbago.
Yeah, we bought Old Farmer McCarty here a number of years ago now.
Why, this is my Aunt Julia. I'd forgotten, did she?
Of course. Yeah, Doc Gibbs lost his wife 2-3 years ago, about this time. And today's another pretty bad blow for him, too.
That's my sister Carrie's boy, Sam. Sam Craig.
I'm always uncomfortable when they're around.
Sorry.
Do they always choose their own verse much, Jim?
No, not usual. Mostly the bereaved pick a verse.
Doesn't sound like Aunt Julia. There aren't many of those Hersey sisters left now. Let me see, where are I wanted to look at my father and mother's.
Over there with the Craigs, Avenue F.
He was an organist at the church, wasn't he? Drank a lot, we used to say.
Nobody was supposed to know about it. He'd seen a peck of trouble. Took his own life, you know.
Oh, did he?
Hung himself in the attic. They tried to hush it up, but of course it got around. He chose on his own epitaph. You can see it there. It ain't exactly a verse.
Why, it's just some notes of music. What is it?
Oh, I wouldn't know. It was written up in the Boston papers, though, at the time.
Joe, what did she die of?
Who?
My cousin.
Oh, did you know? Had some trouble bringing a baby into the world. It was her second though. There's a little boy about 4 years old.
The grave's gonna be over here?
Yes, there ain't much more room for there among the Gibbs. So they're opening up a whole bunch of new Gibbs section over by the Avenue B. You'll excuse me now, I see they're coming.
Who is it, Julia?
My daughter-in-law, Emily Webb.
Well, I declare, the road up here must have been awful muddy. What did she die of, Julia?
In childbirth.
Childbirth. I'd forgotten all about that. My, wasn't life awful and wonderful?
Wonderful? Was it?
Simon, now remember.
I remember Emily's wedding. Wasn't it a lovely wedding? And I remember her reading the class at home at graduation exercise. Emily was one of the brightest girls ever graduated from high school. I've heard Principal Logan say so time after time. I called on them at their new farm just before I died. Perfectly beautiful farm.
Yup, right smart farm.
I always liked that hymn.
you do, Mr. Stacy?
How do you do, Emily?
Mother Gibbs, George and I have made Farmington just the best place you ever saw. We thought of you all the time. We wanted to show you the new barn, the great long cement drinking fountain for the stock. We bought that out of the money you left us.
I did.
Don't you remember, Mother Gibbs? The legacy you left us. Why, it was over $350.
Yes.
Well, there's a patent device on the drinking fountain so that it never overflows, Mother Gibbs, and it never sinks below a certain mark they have there. It's fine. It's a lovely farm. A lot of people don't understand, do they?
No, dear, not very much.
They're sort of shut up in little boxes, don't you think? I feel as though I knew them last 1,000 years ago. Boy is spending the day at Mr. Carter's. Oh, Mrs. Carter, my little boy is spending the day at your house.
Is he?
He loves it there. Mother Gibbs, we have a Ford, too. Never gives any trouble. I don't drive, though, Mother Gibbs. Mother Gibbs, when does this feeling go away? Being one of them helps.
Just wait and be patient.
I know. Look, they're finished. They're going. Look, Father Gibbs is bringing some of my flowers to you. It looks like just like George. Doesn't he? Oh, Mother Gibbs, I never realized before how troubled and how in the dark those people are. Look at him. I loved him so. From morning till night, that's all they are. Trouble.
No.
Yes, that rain's cooled it off a little. Those northeast winds always do the same thing, don't they?
If it isn't a rain, it's a 3-day blow.
But Mother Gibbs, one can go back. One can go back there. Again. Into living. I feel it. I know it. Just then, for a second, I was thinking about the farm. And for a minute, I was there. And my baby was on my lap as plain as day.
Yes, of course you can.
And go back there again and live all those days over. Why not?
All I can say is, Emily, don't.
But it's true, isn't it? I can go and live. Back there, again.
Yes, some have tried, but they soon come back here.
Don't do it, Emily.
Emily, don't. It's not what you think it'd be.
We'll live over a sad day. I'll choose a happy one. I'll choose the day I first knew I loved George. Why should that be painful?
You're not only living, but you watch yourself living.
Yes.
And as you watch it, you see the thing that they, down there, never know. You see the future. You know what's going to happen afterward.
But is that painful? Why?
That's That's not the only reason why you shouldn't do it, Emily. When you've been here longer, you'll see that our life here is to forget all that and think only of what's ahead and be ready for what's ahead. When you've been here longer, you'll understand.
Mother Gibbs, how can I ever forget that life? It's all I know. It's all I have.
Oh, Emily, it isn't wise, really, it isn't.
But it's a thing I must know for myself. I'll choose a happy day, anyway.
No, at least choose an unimportant day. Choose the least important day of your life. It will be important enough.
Then it can't be since I was married. Since the poor baby was born. I can choose a birthday, at least, can't I? I choose my 12th birthday.
All right. February 11th, 1899, a Tuesday. You want any special time of day?
Oh, I want the whole day.
Well, we'll begin at dawn. You remember it had been snowing for several days, but it had stopped the night before and had begun clearing the road. The sun was coming up.
There's Main Street. And that's Mr. Morgan's drugstore, before he changed it. There's the livery stable.
Yep, that's 1899. This is 14 years ago.
It's the town I knew as a little girl. Look, there's the old white fence that used to be around our house. Oh, I'd forgotten that. Oh, I love it so. Are they inside?
Well, your mother will be coming downstairs in a minute to make breakfast.
Will she?
And you remember? Your father had been away for several days. Came back on the early morning train.
No.
He'd been back to his college to make a speech in Western New York at Clinton.
Look, there's Tommy Newsom. There's our policeman. He's dead. He died.
Oh, Bessie. Bessie. Morning, Bill.
Morning, Howie.
You're up early?
Been rescuing a party car near froze to death down by Polish town there. Got drunk and lay out in the snow drifts. Thought he was in bed when I shook him.
Why, there's Joe Crowell.
Good morning, Mr. Warren. Morning, Howie.
Children! But hurry. Morning, Mr. Newsom. Brr, it's cold.
10 below up by my barn.
Think of it. Keep yourself good wrapped up.
Mama, I can't find my blue carrots anywhere.
Just open your eyes, dear, that's all. I laid it out for you, special, on the dresser there. If it were a snake, it'd bite you.
Yes.
Good morning, Bill. Morning, Mr. Webb. You're up early.
Yeah, it's just the back of my old college in New York State. Been any trouble here?
Well, I was called up this morning to rescue a Polish fella. Darn near frozen that he was.
Oh, we must get in the paper.
Why much?
Good morning, Mother.
Go, Charles.
Oh, fine, I guess. I told him a few things. Everything all right here?
Yes, can't think of anything that's happened. Special. Been bright cold. Howie Newsom says it's 10 below over at his barn.
Yes, well, it's colder than that at Hamilton College. Students' ears are falling off. I ain't Christian. They have any mistakes in it?
None that I noticed. Coffee's ready when you want it. Oh, Charles, don't forget, it's Emily's birthday. Did you remember to get her something?
Yes, I've got something here. Where's my girl? Where's my birthday girl?
Don't interrupt her now, Charles. You can see her at breakfast. She's slow enough as it is. Hurry up, children! It's 7 o'clock, and I don't want to have to call you again.
Can't bear it. They're so young and beautiful. How do they ever have to get old? Mama, I'm here. I'm grown up. I love you all, everything.
There's some surprises waiting for you on the kitchen table.
Oh, you shouldn't have. I can't.
But birthday or no birthday, I want you to eat your breakfast good and slow. I want you to grow up and be a good, strong girl. That there in the blue papers from your Aunt Perry. I reckon that you can guess who brought the postcard album. I found it on the doorstep when I brought in the milk. George Gibbs. Must have come over in the cold pretty early. Right nice of him.
George,
I've forgotten that. Chew that bacon good and slow. It'll help keep you warm on a cold day.
Mama, just look at me 1 minute as though you really saw me. Mama, 14 years have gone by. I'm dead.
You're a grandmother, Mama.
I married George Gibbs, Mama. Wally said too, Mama. His appendix burst on a camping trip to North Conway. I felt just terrible about it. Don't you remember? But just for a moment now, we're all together. Mama, just for a moment, we're happy. Let's look at one another.
And that there in the yellow paper, something I found in the attic among your grandmother's and mother's things. You're old enough to wear it now, and I thought you'd like it.
This is for you. Oh, my mom, it's just lovely. It's just what I wanted. It's beautiful.
Well, I hope you'd like it. Hunted all over. Your Aunt Nora couldn't find one in Concord, so I had to send it all the way to Boston. Wally has something for you, too. He made it in manual training class, and he's very proud of it. Be sure you make a big fuss of it. When your father has a surprise for you, too. Don't know what it is myself. Here he comes.
Where's my girl? Where's my birthday girl?
I can't. I can't go on and go so fast. We don't have time to look at one another.
No. The saints and poets, maybe. They do song.
I'm ready to go back.
Were you happy?
I should have listened to you. That's all human beings are. Just blind people.
Look, it's clear enough. Stars coming up.
Mr. Simpson, I should have listened to them.
Yes, now you know. Now you know. That's what it was to be alive. To move about in a cloud of ignorance, to go up and down, trampling on the feelings of those those about you to spend and waste time as though you had a million years, to be always at the mercy of one self-centered passion or another. Now you know, that's the happy existence you wanted to go back to. Ignorance and blindness.
Simon Stetson, that ain't the whole truth and you know it. Emily, look at that star. I forget its name.
My boy Joe was a sailor, knew them all. He'd sit on the porch evenings and tell them all by name. Yes, sir, wonderful.
A star's mighty good company.
Yes, yes it is.
That's funny. Ain't no time for one of them to be here. Goodness sakes.
Kids, George.
Shh, don't just rest yourself.
My boy Joel, who knew the stars, he used to say it took millions of years for that speck of light to get to the earth. Don't seem like a body couldn't believe it. That's what he used to say. Millions of years.
Goodness, that ain't no way to behave.
He ought to be home.
Gibbs?
Yes, someone.
They don't understand, do they?
No, dear. They don't understand.
Everybody to see, and draw the corners. There are a few lights on, and Shorty Hawkins down at the depot just watched the Albany train go by, and at the livery stable, somebody's sitting up late and talking. Yes, it's clear enough. There are the stars, doing their old crisscross journeys in the sky. Scholars haven't settled the matter yet, but they seem to think there are no living beings up there. It's chalk or fire. Only this one is straining away.